Hey, what's going on, Infosecaddicts? Joe McCray here, and I am in sunny San Diego. You can look outside. It's beautiful out there. I'm here this week in San Diego teaching exploit development class, but it's actually exploit development for ARM, mobile device exploitation. It's going pretty good. First day was absolutely wonderful. I had a great, great class. I was so excited. Second day was like the day from hell. I had every single lab. I did not work. Second day, all night, I think I got like an hour sleep that night. I fixed all the labs, got all the labs working for day three. So day three, we got all the labs working. Here we are in day four. I got through the labs. We're really working on a lot of things like return-oriented programming and stuff like that. So that's pretty exciting. We got everything going on ARM, so that was pretty cool. Using these Azeria Labs, I just think that was really cool. I saw a YouTube video of the person who built that, and man, she is smart. Oh my God, good job. It's very good. Good job. Really, really good handiwork. I'm using it for my class right now. Got the exploits from exploitexercises.com and pulled those down. Found somebody who's got them compiled for ARM. Great challenges. We're doing those today. And then we've got a couple of other challenges we're going to do tomorrow. I was kind of thinking that I probably ought to do a whiteboard Friday. I keep forgetting that like they have a whiteboard at this customer. My schedule's been really crazy hectic. Just giving you guys a heads up. I'm going to Norway 2 days from now. So I'm in California now. I go to DC for a Saturday class. So I'm teaching all week. Friday night, I fly back. Saturday, I land, teach a Saturday class, CISSP. And then Sunday morning, I fly to Norway. Then from Norway, I go to London. So crazy times. The Saudi Arabia deal got pushed back, but this is the life. You guys always want to know what it's like. I hope you've been checking out the Mentor Moments. So we're still doing Joe on the Road, but you definitely got to check out Mentor Moments. This is it. So take a look at Mentor Moments, and it's the kind of things that I think you guys should be thinking about. Hopefully I'll be giving you guys pretty good tips that'll help you guys get better. I sincerely wish I was there with you in Norway. I apologize for not being there. I ran into some family issues, so that actually caused me to have to stay right now. I'm gonna try to see if I can make my way there. What they told me at the airport didn't sound good, but I really, really hope that I can get my plane ticket stuff sorted so I can make my way there. I actually need to be in London next week, so it would behoove me to get my butt to Norway. Been coming to Norway every year for the last few years teaching this class. So every year we make a lot of changes to the class, new things that we want to try, trying to make the class more more relevant to what's going on in the industry. So this year, the things that I wanted to kind of throw in the mix will be a little bit more focus on Python 3. Python is really big in the security industry. A little bit more focus on mobile exploitation. Pretty important. Okay, let's get started. In our world, there's a vulnerability scanning tool called NESSUS. So NESSUS is a tool that people use when they want to look for security vulnerabilities in an environment. So you run NESSUS, you point it at a network, and you say, NESSUS, this IP range. And NESSUS comes back with a list of all the security vulnerabilities that it finds in an environment. I ran NESSUS against one of my classes, and I made it export a CSV file. So it exported a CSV file that had the scan results. Okay, so let's talk about reading CSV files. What we've got here is we want to be able to interact with CSV files. So we've got a module called CSV. So I've downloaded my class NESSUS file. When I ran it against one of my previous classes, it ends up looking like this. So you can see for each machine in the network, it's got a plugin ID for the check that Nessus ran. It's got common vulnerabilities and exposures, right? Which is a tracking system for vulnerabilities. It's got CVSS, which is a criticality scoring system for vulnerabilities, a risk rating, and then IP addresses, and then all the relevant information, protocol, port. I've got this CSV file, and usually you don't read CSV files from a command line. It's a lot easier to read them in spreadsheets, but Python can actually let us read these CSV files. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run Python and I'm going to import, if I could type, import CSV, comma separated values. So I want to import this comma separated value. And what I want to do is I want to say, okay, let's F equals open. And I want to open my class underscore Nessus dot CSV file. And I want to open it with the read permission. Okay. Now all I'm going to do is just say for row in F, right? Now remember, every time you have a colon, you have to tab over. Okay. So Python is tab delimited. Okay. And now I'll print the row. Okay. And now it prints out all that data. That was pretty easy. So now all I'm doing here is I'm just going to write a quick script. Well, I've already written it. And the reason I've already written it is because I explained all this and didn't have the recorder on. So I'm re-explaining this while the students are on their lunch break. You can see here, you've got a try finally. Now, usually what happens in Python is you say try except. So like try to do something. If you raise an exception, raise an error, then except handle the error. And then you can say try except or try except finally. I'm writing some bad code here. So this is just a little lazy on my part. And I'm just saying try finally. So all this does is this prints out that CSV file's contents. And you can see how it separates the data. You can see what data is comma separated. You can see all these values are all separated by commas. Okay. But it doesn't read very well. It's a little tough to read. So we write a little bit more Python and we're going to use csv.reader. So I will vi read csv2.py. There we go. All right, so what ends up happening is I import CSV. So I import the CSV module. Rather than just calling it F, you can call it whatever you want, but I'm going to call it iFile this time for input file. So the input file is this Nessus, right, .csv, and I'm reading it with the read permissions. Here's my csv.reader. Now, csv.reader, you give it the argument of the file you want it to read. I'm lazy, so I'm just going to call it reader. Now, what you're going to do for the logic of this program is you're going to say row num equals zero. Row num is zero. That's the row. So we're going to call this the header row because this is where the header, all the labels are. Row num equals zero for row in reader. For every row in reader, if row num equals zero, call it the header row. Now, as soon as we go to our very next row, row num is no longer zero. So now he says, okay, if row num is no longer zero, column equals zero, for column in the row, for column in the row. since row number is no longer zero, jump to the column and say for column in the row, right? That's that block of data right there. I want you to print the header, the column, and the data that's in it, okay? So you want to print the header, which is the name. You want to jump to the column, and then you want to print the data that's in it. Okay, so you want to print the plugin ID, jump to the column, print the data that corresponds to it. And then you're going to do that, and then after that, you're going to increment the column. In other words, you're going to jump over to the right one and do it again. Jump over to the right one, do it again. Jump over to the right, do it again, right? So you'll print the header, go to the column, print the data that corresponds to it. Once you've finished going through all of them, then you increment the row number and do it all again. So this is what makes your data formatting look a little bit different. You guys notice that? So now every piece of data, what it corresponds with now is written out. So now in the next one, I do the exact same thing, but I make it a little bit more robust, right? So in the next one, I say, go to number three. Go to number three. All the logic above it is the same, but go to number three. Okay, 0, 1, 2, 3. And right here, anything in here, I want you to lowercase it. You notice all these have a capital first letter? I want you to lowercase all these. That's what you're saying. Find these ones that say hi and lowercase it so that it's just the word hi like this. If the word hi is in that column, you're only going to print that column. This way, we only get high profile vulnerabilities. Vulnerabilities with a high criticality rating. We don't want the mediums and the lows. We only want the highs. That's what this script is doing. So this script only prints out those results that have a high vulnerability, right? So we don't want the ones with the lows and the mediums and all that. So you notice everything that it prints out has a high risk rating. The problem with this is we have a lot of duplicate IPs. So if I just want to know what are my high vulnerabilities in the environment, this is great. But what if I'm in a situation where your boss is just like, go grab these machines that have high vulnerabilities, and you just need to know what IPs have high vulnerabilities? Well, in that case, we're going to take the same logic and we're going to go a little further with it. I want the high vulnerabilities, but I'm going to create something called a dictionary. So this dictionary is basically a variable, right? So if anything is in here, let me know, right? So if row 3, lowercase it, has the word high in it, and row 4 is the IP address. This is 4. So if that IP address is not in host, then host row 4 equals row 4. So throw this in the host bucket. Make sense, guys? So you're going, look for all of them that have a high vulnerability, check its IP address. If its IP address is in host, no problem. If its IP address is not in host, put its IP address in host and then print out everything, then go to the next row and do it all over again. This way we remove duplicate IPs. So it allows us to print out everything without duplicate IPs. Okay? So what's happening is just on the job, your boss might say, I need you to tell me all the machines that have high vulnerabilities so that we can fix them, right? And this will be a way that you can do it, just a way to think about it programmatically.
So I'm in Newark, New Jersey right now, just landed. It's, what time is it? 5:18 a.m. So I'm on the bus onto my next terminal, so I gotta go to Terminal A. I fly in another hour, and that'll get me to D.C., and I'll be teaching a class at 9 a.m. This week was pretty good. Mobile exploit development, good. Couple of days in there were really bad. A lot of labs didn't work. I ended up learning a lot myself, you know. Mobile is definitely not my area of expertise, so having to develop content for that and having to move into that space was definitely new for me. I can definitely tell you, check out Azeria Labs. I thought that was just so well done, but good job. Definitely check out the ARM assembly tutorials from Derek Banas. It's got a really good set of tutorials for ARM assembly. It just says assembly language tutorials. It's all done on Raspberry Pi. Conveniently, that's where that Azeria Labs boots up. It boots up in Kimu and runs Raspberry Pi inside of it. I thought it was really good. I'll be putting the link to all that link down here for Azeria Labs and ARM assembly. So definitely check that out. And then also don't sleep on the Mentor Moments video series. So here's the link for Mentor Moments. Right, definitely check that out. I think you guys are gonna like what's coming. You guys take care.